My name is Tyler David, and you're watching Field of Dreams on ACTN.
Okay, I just saw you playing all day, and you look real good. Who are you?
Well, you know, I'm Ilunga Kiza. I'm the best footballer pointer of the season.
Oh, really? You know any of the older players who play here?
Well, I know Warren Archibald, Leroy Dillion.
Stop. You know me? Boy, I was the best striker, the best forward that this country ever seen.
Oh, Wilfred K.
Boy, I'm Steve David, boy. Welcome to Field of Dreams on ACTN. My name is Steve David, and I'm your host. Today, I talk with the general in Trinidad and Tobago football that everybody knows about. I wouldn't blow the secret yet until you see him. So let me just introduce my co-host. My co-host, Narada Wilson. Narada, welcome to the set, bud.
It's a pleasure to be here one more time, and as you said, the general is here, and I guess our guests, our fans would enjoy the program tonight.
Right, fans, kick back, sit back. We have the great, the ever-popular Russell Atapi. Russell, welcome to the set, bud.
Thank you, gents. Thank you for having me.
Russ, I wanted to have you on this show because your story is so big, and I don't know you as well, and Trinidad, I'm sure, wants to know who you are. So, first, I want to know, what are you doing now? What's the situation with you now?
I'm presently the coach for the national under-17 and under-15 teams, and as ever, here to support Trinidad football and the association in any way that I can.
Right, you totally involved with the under-17, and that's perfect. Right. Let's start from your childhood, bud. You born and grew up in what part of Trinidad?
Yeah, I was born and bred in Laventille.
Laventille?
Yeah. Dorata Street, Laventille is where I was born and bred. I lived there for most of my life until I had a spell in San Fernando when I went to San Fernando Technical Institute. And unfortunately, at the age of 16, I had the opportunity to go on trial at Bradford City. Back in that time, it was a lot harder than it is now to get a work permit, so I didn't get a work permit, although I was offered a two-year contract, and came back to Trinidad, played with the strike squad, and I suppose everybody knows the story from there.
The rest is history, right?
The rest is history.
You know, growing up in Laventille, was it as it is now?
No. You know, again, I've lived abroad for a lot of years. I've been back living in Trinidad August 2016. And you listen to the news and you hear people talking about stuff. And it definitely wasn't like that back when I grew up, you know. And I know a lot of people hear these stories, but it's the truth in my life. You know, when I was growing up, if my neighbor tried to discipline me, then I had to listen, because if I didn't, then my neighbor can discipline me there on the spot. And then if you go and he tell my parents, then I get disciplined again, you know. So that is the way it was back in the time that I was growing up. And, you know, the whole community looked after each other, but presently, there seemed to be a lot of violence in the area, and and we need to be positive role models to see if we can stop some of this violence.
Yeah, back in the day, it did take a whole neighborhood to raise a kid because everybody could beat you.
Yeah.
If they wanted to and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, right there on the spot, you would get it if you didn't be careful, you know.
Not no more. Nobody wants you to put their hand in the kid.
It seemed to be a bit the other way these days, that if you try to discipline a child for whatever reason, then they go and they tell their parents, and then their parents come in for you too. You know, it seemed to go all the way around, unfortunately. But we have to stay positive, and hopefully we can help change things for the better.
My question to him would be probably, could you relate some of your childhood memories of playing football in Laventer? Where was the football grounds at the time?
Yeah.
And also, have you been back there, and are your friends or colleagues who you played with around? What is the response like?
Yeah, I grew up in the buildings, the Plannings, and it's on the Rata Street. And so growing up, there were three buildings on this side, and we would call, and then on the other side, we would call it Donkey City. There were another two buildings. I was just trying to remember what they used to call our buildings.
Right.
So there was a big rivalry. And there was just a little space in the middle that was just big enough to play 3v3.
Right.
It wasn't any bigger to play anything else, and there was a lot of rocks and whatever. So there was a lot of rivalry and a lot of competition. And fortunately for me, two elder brothers at the time, so that would be my tree.
Right.
So the elder one would defend, the middle one would play in the middle, and then I would play up top, you know.
Right.
And it was like one goal come off, so you had to win. And if you don't score, then and you're out, then it could take you like a half hour to get back in, you know.
Right.
That kind of thing.
You know, growing up in Point, went to Point for the EC school, and in third standard, I was playing a game, and there was a teacher says, this kid have a little something that maybe we can do, use. And I went straight and started playing for the school in primary school football.
Yeah.
When did it all start for you?
Again, just playing there in the yard. And back in that time, Jamal Shabazz, who was also from around the area, He founded a team, which is still in existence, Caledonia, AIA, back in the day. So he formed a team at that level. So I went straight away, and that was my first competitive football team. And then straight away, there were screening for a national under 12 team. So so obviously, I was asked to go and take part in these screenings. And that is when I met a lot of my lifelong friends. You know, we all played football at that time. Brian Lara, Dwight York, Shaka Hislop, Kuna Hislop. You know, these are the boys that was part of that team.
So so you wasn't involved in, like, primary school football competitively?
Yeah, not competitively, really. I went to Richmond Street Boys Anglican School, and we played there, and we played like the inter-house and that sort of stuff. But I don't really have a lot of memories of playing competitive at Richmond Street at the time. I do have a lot of memories of playing for Tranquility, because from Richmond Street, I went to Tranquility. And it was a big football school back in the time, Intercult football, and I have a very fond memory of playing Intercult football in Form 1, you know. It was just a little thing. I'm still small right now, but in Form 1, and I remember the coach putting me on with 20 minutes to go against QRC and QRC Ground, and that was like a really big thing for me back in the day, and I suppose that gave me a lot of belief in going further.
Was that like your breakout? You know, there's some game or some occasion is like your breakout. All right, now I think.
I think that was the game. In saying that, I was already playing international football at under 12. But I suppose when you move up into a different age group and you're this small and you're playing against guys who were 17, 18 at the time, and I would have been about 12 or 13, somewhere around there at the time, then it gives you the belief that I can really do this. But I also have to make mention of a coach who saw my talent from an early age. And there's a lot of coaches who came into my life that taught me to play football and taught me about life. But in particular, I'm speaking about a guy called Ja Lily White, you know, because at the time, you know, and he still does it up today, you know, his ideas and the way he wants to play football, the way he teaches football, and the way he deals with young people and young footballers. And, you know, and I can remember that everybody would be partying for Carnival, and Ja would have a couple of us in the Savannah. And I can remember he throwing the ball up in the air, left foot, right foot, left foot, arms out for balance, and he's always at us, you know. And some of the things that you didn't really understand at the time, but you're saying, well, why are you having your arms out if it's your foot you're using, you know? And then once you develop later in life, you realize your hands out for balance actually keeps the opponents away, you know?
Right.
So these are the little things that that made a difference. But he had the foresight to teach us this from a young age, so it became normal in our game to do these things.
I understand. It's like you're juggling the ball. You don't juggle the ball in football field, but teaches you touch. And
exactly. You know, a feel of the ball. Of
so I understand that totally. Yeah. So now you 12 years old in the national football team for us. But when did you get into like any club football or any league football?
Yeah. Well, after Tranquility, I suppose, I was always in and around Caledonia at the age. And again, that's one of the things that these kids now are a bit different, you know. Back in the day, we were playing four games on a weekend or five games on a weekend. We were representing three, four different teams, you know, wherever there's a game. So after Tranquility, I was always with Ja, you know, because I loved the way that he was doing things, and I felt as though I was learning a lot. But that's the thing about Ja. He didn't play in any league.
Right.
You know, he would play exhibition games or bongs games. He would organize to play practice games and that. But he never played in a league. So you would play the games with Ja, but you would have your other club that you would go and play. But I think competitive football would have started really at a high level. If we take the national system out of it, would have been at Sando Tech and after San Fernando Tech when I left Tranquil. And then I went straight into Trintoc. It's Trintoc back in the day, you know. So I went into Trintoc, and at 15 years old, I was already playing for Trintoc, and I won the National League at 15 years old with players like Stuart Charles, Clayton Morris, Anthony Street, Philbert Jones, fantastic team, Larry Joseph, you know, to name a few.
And you in your early teens. I mean, our competitive league as a teenager was really high school.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Because college there was no league, and you're good enough to get into the minor leagues. And,
exactly.
And you do your thing. You don't know about that, right?
No, that shocked you.
That's a long time.
It does show that the amount of football, it was a lot more.
Right.
You know, I think even with the structure that we have today, we're taking a direction, but you're seeing that in your time, you all were playing every opportunity you could get, whether it's secondary school, if you want to call it like a university or the professional.
Whatever little space you had, you would play football. Wow.
So your first call onto the national team, big team, was?
At 16 years old. At 16 years old, and if my memory serves me right, I think there are two other players who represented the national senior team at 15, and a bit, which would be Gally Cummins and Clint Marcel, and I was just a couple months later at 16. So I started to play at 16 under the coaches, DTC's Roderick Warner, and Mohamed Issa. They were the two coaches at the time, and for some reason, they gave me the number 10 at 16 years old, and I kept it for the next 25 years.
Do you think you understood the responsibility back then of the
number? No, okay. Canada as a 16-year-old, you know, as a 16-year-old, you know that some of the top players in the world and the top teams, they wear number 10, number 7, and these things. So, so you know that they're going to give the number 10 top to somebody who is technically gifted, you know. So they gave me the 10 top, and I just wanted to play football, and they could have given me the number 1 or the number 25. It didn't really matter to me. I just wanted to play. But it was a great learning curve for me because I got involved with a lot of senior players who some of them just on their way out, basically, who really looked after me as a young kid and guided me through, you know, the early years.
I carried the number 10 and trainer team as well, but as a forward, you know, but our, as far as I'm concerned, our general was Galli. Mm-hmm. And you remind me so much of Galli when I saw you play. He controls everything. Yeah. He always, you know. And so maybe Galli should have carried our number 10, but I got a number 10. He was another thing. But you guys are so
similar traits.
Similar in your ability and everything, man. So it looked like Galli took the whole thing and dropped it on your back. That is, you carried the mantle.
And again, I was fortunate as well because I had Galli at the strike squad days, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think that, and again, if my memory serves me right, I had Roderick and Anissa. And after this phrase for strike squad, that's when Galli took over. And I would have been 2 or 3 years old at the time. So I got Galli at strike squad at pretty much 18, 19 years old. And he did a fantastic job, and he taught us a lot, you know. If we think about what he achieved with the strike squad, was, in my mind, nothing short of amazing, you know. Was locally based players, not one professional we had back in the day, you know. And he shaped us into to a unit that that played for each other and who he gave our football in my mind an identity, you know. Again, I think we've always had certain players and played a certain way, and I think we're better as a nation when we play that way. And I think Galli as an ex-player identified that and shaped us into playing that way, and it brought a lot of pride to the whole nation, you know. And I suppose just as a nation at the time, I don't think we were quite ready to qualify. And I know this would be a bit controversial, what I'm going to say, but it's my views. I know a lot of people blame the technical staff and the federation and that sort of stuff. I'm thinking that we travel from that far and
A lot of conspiracy
and all that sort of stuff. But in my mind, I don't think as a nation, I don't think we were quite ready, and we weren't a footballing nation and like we are today. I don't think the general public had the understanding of the game 20 years ago or 30 years ago that we do know.
Okay, Russell, when we come back, I want you to just talk to me, because we're going to take a break now. I want you to talk to me about this strike squad, your interaction with that group, and how you guys move forward. All right, viewers, we'll be right back after a short break.
I enter qualifying, and when you don't, you know, it's a big knock, you know, you're taking a big knock there. So we regrouped and I fortunately got the opportunity to go to Portugal.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. WorldwideSafety@yahoo.com.
Okay, viewers, welcome back to ACTN, Field of Dreams, ACTN. Russell, before the break, we were talking about, you just mentioned about the strike squad and with Gally and the rest of the gang, and you guys had a real knitted team that we were hoping to get to the World Cup. You didn't make it, like we didn't, but mm-hmm. You guys, I'm sure there's a lot of memories that you want to talk about.
Yeah, some wonderful memories. You know, it's there were a lot of times in my life that gave me the belief and the strength to move forward, because a lot of kids look at you and they think that, you know, everything came easy, you know, but in life, like in football, you get a lot of knockbacks and you need to keep moving on. And I think the strike squad, that was a time that gave me the confidence and the belief to know that I can do anything that I wanted to do in football and go as far as I wanted to go, because, you know, a bunch of locally based coaches and players were able to reach within touching distance of the greatest football show on earth, you know, and we competing with, you know, and people talk about America, they know how to play football, but they are superpower as well in whatever they do, because whatever they put their mind to, they invest in it and they study it and they do the best that they can. And then again, we competing with Mexico at the time, and, you know, and people tend to forget that Mexico have a population of 100 million. And if we just talk of sheer numbers, you know, mm-hmm. young boys who are playing football right. with that size of population is more than our entire population, you know. So we competing with really good teams and being able to do what Gally and the strike squad did, you know, and the togetherness in the team and the players, it gave you a lot of belief in knowing that whatever you wanted to achieve, if you put your mind to it, you can.
Right. I thought in strike squad days you guys had a lot of pressure on it. You guys were pretty young, group. Dwight and
yeah, Dwight, and Marvin. You know, we were teenagers, 17, yeah. 18, somewhere around there at the time, you know. But we were fortunate because we had people there like we had Michael Maurice, we had Clayton Morris, we had Brian Williams, you know, experienced players, Hudson Charles, you know, experienced players who were there to always look after you and guide you the right way. And I suppose these experiences and interacting and living with these players kind of dictates the way that your personality is shaped.
And Gally was a young coach as well. He just finished with us, and he come up and he got this gig mm-hmm. to coach a national team. Yeah. And he said, and he on this show and other things, he said he was trying to emulate our team and bring this player and bring this player, because mm-hmm. he didn't have the experience. So he did what he had to do, and yeah. you guys made the country proud, man.
Yeah, but I think what Gally also did in my mind is that he identified and I suppose developed or tried to develop a brand, which is our way, the way that we play, you know, and I think that is underestimated, because a lot of times, for example, we look at the games on TV and we see Germany play, you know, and we try to emulate things that the Germans do, right. It's just impossible. We build differently, we think differently, our culture is different, you know, so it's impossible. I think what Gally did is he was able to see and understand our culture, the way we live, the way we think, the way we rest, the way we eat, and he was able to take all of that and find the best possible way for us to play football.
He even tried to give it a name, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. Thai soccer or something like that.
And I still think that is the way to go.
And you guys is the one who start naming the team with a name. Our team never had a name. You had Strike Squad, right?
Yeah.
So you guys got an identity. Yeah. You had songs like. Yeah. When I came, I was living abroad. I came to Trinidad.
Maximus Dance. Yeah.
Latta's Dance or something like that, right? You had all that going for you.
A lot of
branding.
And I think the other thing with Gali as well, you know, he designed the tub that we use as well. Mm-hmm. You know, so straight away when anybody see the tub, they were able to identify themselves or whoever it was with,
think it is
with this particular project.
It is one of the replicas or the T-shirts that it's most recognized, you know. Wow. Once you see it, everyone knows right away, you know, it is the Strike Squad era. Yeah.
So this this is done. This, we
you're on the national
we
team.
We had a foot in the door, and mm-hmm. we stepped out. Now it's after that game.
Yeah.
What's your condition mind-wise, and where did you go from there?
Yeah. What happens there is that... so much of your energy and your hopes, aspirations are into qualifying, and when you don't, you know, it's a big knock, you know, you're taking a big knock there. So we regrouped and I fortunately got the opportunity to go to Portugal and try to play professionally. So I went to Portugal, a football agent took me. And the first club he took me to was Porto. Now, back in the day, you were only allowed to have 3 foreign players. Going to a club like Porto, we had players who were playing there like Branco, Brazilian left back. We had Geraldo, we had Maggi. There was a lot of top international players, so... It was hard to get in the door, especially coming from a nation that nobody really knows in the football world, you know. And when you go from Trinidad, where is that? In Africa?
That's
you know what I mean? So you had to fight your way in. And eventually the coach sent me to Porto's farming team, a team called Gil Vicente. Knowing football agents working all the time, my agent was able to get me a better deal at the time with another club called Academica. So I went to Academica and I had 3 or 4 wonderful years at Academica. And just, I was fortunate again in my football career to get wonderful coaches who allowed me to go and express myself.
Right.
So with Academica, for example, the coach kind of built a structure around the way I played.
Right.
So tactically, I didn't really have any responsibilities.
Yeah.
My responsibility was to get the ball and make things happen offensively.
Right.
So in doing that, I was enjoying myself. That was like playing back home in the yard, getting the ball and having fun. And not knowing to me, Porto, the eyes were always on me all the same. And 3 or 4 seasons after, they came back to Academica and they got me. That time, Bobby Robson, did you see? Sir Bobby Robson was the coach at Porto, and Jose Mourinho
mm-hmm.
was working with him there at the time. So I went to Porto and I spent 2 years there, and I think that is when the tactical aspect of my game really developed, because playing with Academica, you're playing just in the domestic league, and you know that you're not going to get demoted, and you're going to try to win the league, so you're just going and playing football. But when I went to Porto now, and we're playing Champions League and UEFA competitions, then if you really want to get a game on the team, the tactical side of your game needs to be be up to scratch as well, you know, because if you go away and you play to Inter or Sampdoria or Nantes, as I did back in the day, then you can't only attack, you have to defend,
of course.
And And that was when my knowledge of the game, especially the tactical aspect, really developed.
Right. So, don't you feel at that point in time, now you get the experience, you can adjust to whatever they want you to do, if they want you to, mm-hmm. because I'm saying this because I'm thinking in myself when I had the opportunity. If they want you to carry the ball, you can carry it. If they want you to knock it off first time, you can knock it off. Whatever they want you to do at this point in time, your game is, yeah. is developed to that.
And yeah, absolutely, because when I went to Porto, I actually played, they played with two wingers. They had mm-hmm. wonderful, wonderful wingers at Porto at the time. And they would play with two strikers, you know, one up top and one behind. So. Mm-hmm. I actually had to try and get a place as one of the two in midfield, you know. So I had to readjust and reestablish myself, not only as an offensive player, but as a complete midfielder, you know. So otherwise I wouldn't get a game, you know.
Right.
So yeah, I did readjust the way I played, and I was fortunate enough to win two league medals with Porto, and in that period, you know, it's a big thing in Portugal. Porto won 5 straight league championships, and I was part of the first two. So that is something when I'm back in Portugal that a lot of people remembers.
And in addition, I hope my viewers understand, you fighting for only 3 spots on that team,
yeah.
because. The rest of the players has to be locals from that country, yeah. right? And or
well, what happened back in this time now, mm-hmm. Which was a couple of years later, then the rules changed a bit, and then the European Union came into play, and
okay.
But it was still difficult. So yeah, the difference was is that if you're from outside of Europe, you're still fighting for 3 places.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
But if you're European, so if you're German or Spanish or whatever, you're not considered a foreigner as before. But right. but it's still difficult because, you know, you're having players there from Chile, South Americans, Africans, as you rightly said. And then because it's the same language, Portuguese and Brazilian, is. They speak Portuguese, you get a lot of Brazilians there. It's just right. a natural fit for them, you know.
Right.
So it's really hard when you're coming from a nation like Brazil. Well, really easy, I should say. And really hard when you're competing and you're from Trinidad with a Brazilian. And it's normal. It's just the coaches. They think, okay, Brazilians, they have a... And a lot of times it has nothing to do with your ability. But until the coaches really get to know you, mm-hmm. then they think that they have a stronger footballing mentality.
So you left Trinidad, the whole of Trinidad know who Russell Atapi is. Now you go to Portugal, and now the world is starting to know who Russell Atapi is. So after Porto, mm-hmm. where did you move?
I spent 2 years at Porto, and then I moved on to Boa Vista. Again, it was a wonderful time back in the day, Boa Vista. They were... Premier League club, doing really well, European competitions. Again, I had 2 wonderful years there, and then I thought I wanted to try a different football. So at approximately 28 or 29, I moved on from Portugal, and I thought I'm going to see if I can to England. So I went and trialed a couple of clubs in England, Aston Villa, Dwight was there. Mm-hmm. At the time, I was offered a 1-year contract at Villa back in the day, and the manager was John Gregory, and then Manchester came in for Dwight, and he wanted Dwight to stay, and long story, but Dwight had to go and to Manchester, because if Manchester or Real Madrid or Barcelona comes in for you, you know, that's
right, like
a no-brainer.
Coming for you, right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I didn't stay at Villa. I went to Barnsley. I went to Ipswich. So I went on trial with a couple of clubs, and for one reason or the other, I never stayed. And then Anthony Rozier, he was at Hibs, and he was telling the manager Alex McLeish about me a lot, and Alex invited me up. And at that time, I was just a bit tired for bouncing around two or three clubs, and I just thought, okay, I'll go up there for a season. And it was a really easy deal because I said to Alex before I went up, okay, I'm going to come up and play one game, and these are my conditions. If you don't accept these conditions, then we're wasting each other time. So he said, yeah, come up and let's have a look at you. So I went up there on a Monday. I played a game on a Tuesday, and in a place called Brecon, right? And if I can tell you where Brecon is, you know, it's just one of these third division teams with a tight little ground, and it was a Tuesday night in the winter, and it was absolutely freezing there, you know? Yeah. And after an hour in the game, Alex took me off, and he said to me that he wanted me to play on the Saturday. And I went, okay, well, it's a done deal. And so I played for three seasons at Hibs, and then I moved on to the Glasgow Rangers for another two seasons, a season and a half, which was another wonderful experience there. You know, I was it's a massive club, and I'm sure most people have heard of the Old Firm Derby. That's Celtic and Rangers, you know, and it's a very fiery affair that it's a privilege to take part in a game like that. And we had a wonderful squad there. We had players like Claudio Canisia. We had Arthur Newman. The manager was Dick Advocaat. Had a lot of top players in the club there. So I spent another season and a half, two seasons there. I was fortunate again there to win competitions with Rangers. And then I was thinking of retiring. I was about 34, approximately, 33, 34. And I was thinking, okay, that was enough. That's a lot of football. And one of the players that I played with at Hibs was now getting into management. And he asked me to come and play a season with him, and part of the deal was that I'd be able to do some coaching, because when I was at the end of my career, I was unsure of what direction I wanted to go. So I bounced around a bit. I did a bit of journalism, I did a bit of game analysis, and a bit of coaching, and then I kind of figured out that I like how the coaching going. You know, I'm comfortable doing it, and I felt that I was imparting knowledge onto the young ones, and that was really satisfying. So I thought that I'd go there for 1 year, and I ended up playing at Falkirk for five years. So at the end of every season, he would say, "Are you feeling good enough to play one more?" I said, Let's see, and then and I keep going.
One year at a time.
Yeah. So I played there for five seasons, and I actually finished my career there professionally abroad at approximately 39, 40 years old.
I know that Rangers and Celtics had competition. I also saw, I think you scored a goal when Rangers beat Celtics 2-1. I can't remember that game, but we're going to take a break now, but when we come back, I want you to tell us a little bit about that rivalry, because it's like Manchester United, Arsenal or something, you know? And so on and so on. We'll talk a little bit about that. We'll be right back after the show.
From the national team, maybe on three or four different occasions, right? And
that's where Molino got his stuff from.
I think it was done a bit differently.
Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited offers solutions to your immediate and future potential problem areas by providing you with a qualified team of safety consultants. Worldwide Safety Consultants Limited, building a reputation on quality and value since 1999. Located 23 Todd Street, San Fernando, Trinidad. Phone 868-657-1534 or 868-788-6955. worldwidesafety@yahoo.com.
Viewers, welcome back. Before the break, I was talking to the general about his experiences in the Scottish League, okay. Rangers. And like I said, I saw a couple of games with you that with the Celtics-Ranger rivalry mm-hmm. was so big. And then you also played for Hibernian.
Yeah.
So which of these clubs was... Talk about them all if you want to.
The rivalry between Celtic and Rangers is not only football, you know, it is also a religious thing that has come all the way through the years, you know. Rangers are Protestants and Celtic, they're Catholic, so, you know, there's a big difference there, you know, and... It is fiery, you know. It's passionate for these people. They are passionate people. They're lovely people. So I had a wonderful time there. But I would say that it is funny enough, and I say this to a lot of the kids, that I had the most fun in my football career playing at Falkirk, and simply because I went there at approximately 34 years old or 35 years old, and I knew that every game could be my last, right? So I just enjoyed playing football, and because the manager was an ex-teammate, he understood what I brought to the team, so again, he would organize the team in a way that, and we played with the diamond formation, which mm-hmm. is, I would be behind... Yeah. The striker, and we have three younger guys who would do all the chasing. Yeah. And they would just give it to me, and I can turn and play forward, you know. And it was just a wonderful 5 years. And with a small team who achieved things that was great for a small club.
Now, we had a national team trying to get into the World Cup. And we were struggling. And then they says, we have to get more help. So they get Benaka. And they says, mm-hmm. we got to come. We have a guy we need to bring to this team to change the complexion. Mm-hmm. And they got the person they wanted, which was you. Tell me about that.
Well, it is during the course of my career with the national team, for various reasons, I've retired from the national team. I had retired from the national team maybe on three or four different occasions, right? And
that's where Molino got his stuff from.
I think it was done a bit differently.
All right.
So what happens when you're playing abroad is that, you know, most teams they train at a certain time. So on most mornings, I would speak to Dwight. He would be driving into work. I would be driving into work, and we would chat about all sorts of things. So we would also chat about the national team. And one morning, we were chatting about the national team, and he had come back by this time, and he said to me, and his words was that we're missing a piece of the puzzle. And I kind of said, well, where's that? And he said, well, it's you. We're missing you, you know. And he understood the complicated relationship that I've had with Mr. Warner and the Federation that we won't get into, but it's documented. So he kind of said to me that, you know, he would like me to come back, that kind of thing. And I said to him that, okay, if he's asked me as a friend, then I'd definitely come back. And at this time, we had, I believe, 4 games to play. And if we didn't get any points in the upcoming 2 games, we could just forget it. So I said to him that I'd come back for 2 games, right? And I believe that was Guatemala and Panama. I believe, Guatemala and Panama. So we got the results here against Guatemala, and I think in Panama we got the results. I think Stern scored, and we won 1-0 there. And then obviously if I came back for the two, then I had to go to the other two because we still had a chance, you know. So, yeah, so I think that was Mexico and USA. And, we got the desired results that put us into the playoff position. And then, obviously, again, you go, okay, well, it's two more, you know. So you went and you played two more. So, you know, and it's a situation that I would take this opportunity to mention. You know, a lot of people don't really know everything that happened, you know, but I said to the players, you know, and there's one particular person who keeps going about Dwight and myself being leaders and again involved in the fight against, but I just thought it was unfair. I just came back for 6 games and I don't know what the negotiation was like, so I didn't get involved in that particular situation. But yeah, and then we went to Bahrain, and Dennis, fantastic header he scored, you know, and got us to the World Cup, and that was the most amazing feeling ever, you know, because I actually tried to qualify for the World Cup on 5 occasions before.
And we did. Yeah.
And, you know. And then if you think about it, the World Cup is every 4 years, yeah. You know. So I've been trying to qualify for the World Cup for the past 20 years before. And, you know, when I'm 37 years old, I was able to help my country qualify for the World Cup.
But you mentioned Stern scoring a goal. But to me, the turning point was when you just came, the goal that you scored to make it, it was 2-1?
2-1.
Yeah.
I thought that was the turning point at that. Yeah. That whole us going to that 2016. That was your first game back, right?
Yeah, that was my first game back. That was my first game back, and I could remember the goal. You know, it's coming on the right. Carlos went down. He played it inside to me, left me 1-on-1 with the defender, and I suppose most people who saw me play football know that it doesn't matter which foot the ball drops on. You know. Capable of using both of them, and I thought the defender thought that if he gives me the left side, I'm just as accurate, you know, and I suppose that is where we started to build a bit of momentum in the whole campaign, and it gave the nation a bit of belief. But I also think what is important as well is that for the players, you know, I think if I'm not really good about talking about myself, right? But I suppose for the players, if you have two of arguably the best players that ever passed through the country on the field playing, I suppose that gives you a bit of belief as well that we can do this, you know. So that was part, in my mind, of the whole momentum that was building there. And then the country, they jump on board. And again, I think at this particular time, we were a footballing nation more than we were back in the strike squad days. And I think the understanding from the general public was different. They were more knowledgeable, and they were able to support the team in a different way.
Okay, we qualify, and I know you want to know about this, Narada. We have 3 games in the first round. Mm-hmm. So our coach went in, and I mean, great coach, great strategy, maybe defensive. So we're gonna hold Latapia a little back, and we're not gonna play him in the first game. So we get a result, not a result, we get a draw. Mm-hmm. How you feel at that time? And I want you to take me from that. Mm-hmm. Through the other games and how you feel about how that happened.
Well, firstly, when we qualified for the World Cup, that was I had accomplished my dream, I set out to. And don't get me wrong, like every other player, I wanted to play in the World Cup, But I had a conversation with the coach, and at 37 years old, I know that, going to the World Cup, it would have just been going to the World Cup, you know. Okay. So having a conversation with Mr. Bin Haka, I said to him that if he wanted to take a younger player, then that was fine by me. And he said to me that, no, he wanted me to go. So at 37, you have the experience to know that get yourself fit and get yourself prepared and do the right things to get yourself ready. And I did. So getting there, first game, Sweden, Sid got sent off, Avery got sent off.
Avery. It was the first red card
Got sent off. And then, you know, you needed legs because you're playing 10 against 11. So totally understandable that that I didn't get into that game. Then the second game we play in England, and it's 0-0 after 60 or 70 minutes, and they train on players and that kind of thing. And, you know, and they're backing us up a bit, and I'm thinking, it would be a great opportunity to get on and kind of back them up a bit. But again, you know, it's the coach's vision and ideas, and we all respect it. And I think he did a fantastic job. I think what we did when we went to the World Cup is that we showed the world that we were able to compete at that level, to the highest level. But if I had to say what I would have liked, I wanted us as a nation to show the world the football that we can play, our identity, our style, Kaiso Soka or whatever, you know. And I'm not sure if we were able to do that during the World Cup.
We did, but I want to hear your, because now at this point we had 1 point, we played two games. Mm-hmm. Our only chance of getting in to mm-hmm. the next round is to win the last game.
Yeah.
Now, I have Russell Atherby sitting on my squad. Mm. Why would I hold him off? I'm prompting you because this is my thing. Why would I hold Russell Atherby off to bring him on? Why don't I put him on? And if it's not working out, I could always take him off.
Again, third game.
We
need to win.
We need to win.
I suppose this is a coach's view, opinion, right? You know, I agree with you. If I'm in
the
same
coach,
situation,
would you do?
I would try to play my best offensive players,
right,
who could create goals for me. You know, my way of thinking about football, I prefer to play and try to win than play and not try to lose, you know, and that's a big difference in football, you know. Again, I think, I don't know what his mindset was, but I suppose he was trying to keep it steady and then try to win it at the end. I don't know, but he did a fantastic job, and I appreciate everything that he did for our country and our football, and he's a wonderful man.
You're not only a good footballer, man, you're diplomatic as well. You try to save the coach, I understand, but as far as Steve David is concerned, if I was a coach on that team, I would play you, just make you start that game, let's try to win. If at halftime or after we see we can't win, okay, I'll take you off and I'll put some fresh legs on and do what, or let you finish it, man. Let you finish out, go out with a bang. Yeah. Take the whole game.
I think for me, I think the public just remembering the experience. I think the England game, we were a lot anxious at a certain point, expecting you to come on.
Come on, right.
And then it was Paraguay, right? We thought you were a sure starter for that game. So I think the anticipation was there. My question quickly would be, you had Porto's, you had the experience in Porto, in Scotland, in Trinidad. Which one would you rate as one of the biggest, as a player entering this field? A rivalry with Porto Celtic Rangers experience or Trinidad and Tobago at the strike squad or qualifying for the?
I would say that my greatest footballing experience would definitely be going onto the field in the World Cup. You know, it's the biggest stage you could possibly play at. And as a kid, it's every kid's dream, you know. So once you start to play football, you can see yourself going on to that field in the World Cup, you know. And then it's just achieving it for our nation is singly the biggest thing that I've ever experienced. But I've had some wonderful moments in football, you know. Everything that I have in my life and it's true football, you know. And when you play games like the Old Firm Derby or the Edinburgh Derby or Porto Benfica, you know, they are extremely massive games and you can see what it means to so many people, you know, and you're a player and you're just concentrating and doing your job, you know, but there are people who from year in, year out, you know, this is the games and they live for their football teams and it means so much to them.
All right, we to the end, parting words, any?
Just an appeal to the footballing community that, you know, I think, unfortunately, our footballers are, and I think we all agree, not where we would like it to be, not where it should be. It's not what some of these young people deserve. I think it is a job that no one person would be able to get us back to where we are. So it's just an appeal to the football fraternity, the football community, to give as much support as we can to the new coach, Dennis, because, like I said, he needs everybody's support in order to be successful and give him the support that he needs. And it wouldn't only benefit the senior team, but it would benefit the whole economy and the whole country in general. So let's give him that support that he needs.
For me, it's a pleasure to be here. And I think your story started off with the strike squad, the experience, you know. So you were this close, and then your career ended with the Soccer Warriors. And I think that proves you had a complete football career, and it's a pleasure being here.
Yeah. Okay. I need you to bring Brian and Dwight, and we'll sit down and we'll talk about you guys' friendship and growing up and all of that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
Time. Okay, viewers, we come to the end of the show. Thank you for letting us into your homes. Thank you, Axe Television Network, for giving us the opportunity. To my panel, thank you, Narada, for being here as usual, buddy. And to you, Russell, thank you so much
for
being
here. Thank you very much,
man. I appreciate you so much. And I always like to see you play. And Gally was always my favorite. And you took the mantle and you ran with it. And
thank you.
You push it as high as you could. And now it's for somebody else to do that. And appreciate
absolutely.
You. Thank you so much, viewers. The show is ended. Go in peace. I'll see you next time. Good night.